Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. Iran's quest for the power that comes with the possession of a nuclear arsenal takes place inside a paradox. The Islamic Republic knows full well that it is suspected of edging towards military nuclear potential, and once it is implicated or even suspected of reaching its goal, those nations feeling threatened will strike in order to nip it in the bud. One reason, therefore, that what the Iranians at least really want is to profit by refusing to give up this quest and gain benefits and concessions in exchange for limiting it by reactivating the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. As new President Raisi starts his term, the question is thus, what is the state of play between Tehran, Washington, Jerusalem, London, and Vienna, where the JCPOA renewal and reinforcement talks are being held? To further analyze this topic, we're joined from the United Kingdom by Colonel Richard Kemp, former British Infantry Commander and head of the International Terrorism Intelligence Team at the British Cabinet Office. Thank you for joining us, sir.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Also joining us from Central Israel is Brigadier General in Reserve Yossi Kupil Vasil, who is the Project Director on Middle East Developments at the Jerusalem Center for Public Affairs. Thank you for joining us as well, sir.
Thank you.
And here elsewhere in the building is our TV7 analyst and host of TV7's Watchmen Talk, Mr. Amir Oren. Amir, thank you for joining us as well. The circumstances, of course, being the coronavirus, where we had to maintain a healthy distance. With that being said, let's discuss something less healthy, the Islamic Republic of Iran. What can you tell us about the current situation vis-a-vis this country, which has plenty of aspirations, yet does so in contradiction of international norms and international law, for that matter?
So the contest against the Iranian Republic, the Revolutionary Islamic Republic, is a multidimensional and multi-domain one. And one could, of course, touch on Iraq and Yemen and other places. But the main three battlegrounds right now are the nuclear one on which we will focus here in this talk, and the Iranian effort to entrench its forces, militias, and proxies in Syria in order to take on Israel and to help Hezbollah. And a relatively new frontier, the maritime frontier, in which there have been more and more incidents of late. And above all of these different but not separate issues lies, of course, the domestic issue in Tehran of a very frustrated population taking to the streets to protest against the corruption and incompetence of the regime. The calculations of Supreme Leader Khamenei, as you said, the beginning of the Raisi term in office. And in Vienna, there is something of a freeze. After seven rounds or so of talks indirectly between the Americans and the Iranians through the other parties to the JCPOA, it seems as if everybody is waiting for the Iranians to make the move or make the decisions. Maybe they will now do it when Raisi has his new team in line. Obviously, Foreign Minister Zarif is not going to play such a major role, if at all. And the negotiators in Vienna are going to get new directives. All the while, of course, the Iranians are stepping up their effort to accumulate more and more enriched uranium.
Not to forget, of course, that the new president, Ibrahim Raisi, is and remains sanctioned by the United States for human rights abuses, being one of a panel of four in the early 80s, 83 if I'm not mistaken, where 30,000 Iranians who have been opposing the regime have been condemned to death and hung in the country of Iran, something that does not seem to bother the European Union too much when they sent Enrique Mora to join in the inauguration of this mass murderer. But with that being said, General Kupelvas, I'd like to refer the next question to you. When we're talking about the negotiations with Iran, of course, Israel is a spectator to those negotiations, all the while being quite impacted by any result of or outcome that will come out of those talks. You've been involved in dissuading or trying to dissuade the Americans prior to the 2015 nuclear deal to take into account Israel's wide range of concerns without, of course, infringing on the various freedom of action, if you will, of Israel, but that was less successful, less tentative ears. Is now the current government under the current Prime Minister of Israel, Naftali Bennett, and Foreign Minister Yair Lapid, considering the shift of policy and trying to align themselves with the American, finding a more tentative ear from the Americans, or are we seeing much of the same of what happened pre-2015?
I think what happens now is not that we are finding a better, more listening ear, more tentative ear from our American friends, but that everybody sees what is the policy of Iran, and everybody's upset with the policy of Iran. The Iranians are helping us to convince the Americans that they are marching in the wrong direction. That's why the talks are stuck. And it's not because of the Americans, it's because of the Iranians. The Iranians refuse to accept the American proposal of how to rejoin the JCPOA. And it seems that Raisi is going to be even more stubborn in his attitude towards this matter. So it looks as if it's going to be easier for Israel to convince the Americans that, listen, this direction, this policy is leading nowhere. And not only that it's leading nowhere, but it gives Iran the time necessary in order to continue to accumulate enriched uranium to high levels, to keep on developing advanced centrifuges, to keep on producing uranium metal. All of those things are happening while you are allegedly discussing with the Iranians the future of the Iranian nuclear project. The project moves forward, so something has to be done about it. I think the Americans may understand that this is the case. The problem with the Iranians is that they have a very low learning curve. I mean, what happened again and again is that at a certain point when they are under pressure and they take all kinds of steps that irritate everybody. Until a certain point, there was no reaction by the international community or even by Israel. But from a certain point, the reaction is very harsh. We saw that with the elimination of Qasem Soleimani. We saw it in many other cases. And what happened recently was that the Iranians thought that because the Americans are so eager to rejoin the JCPOA, this gives them a carte blanche to do whatever they like anywhere. And they took this step in the context of the naval frontiers Mr. Owen mentioned, which brought everybody on them. Then the international community, maybe at a certain point, maybe this, maybe the next move of the Iranians is going to be the straw that will break the camel's back. And that's the Iranians never learned this lesson. This happened in 2006 in Lebanon. It repeats itself as always. It happened with Hamas in the last conflict in Gaza in May this year. Again and again, they make the same mistake. And this is something that is an opportunity for Israel to convince the international community that Iran is a danger. Iran is committed to acquire nuclear weapons, the big arsenal of nuclear weapons. That's why we should, and it is a danger for the region. And it's going to help us to convince everybody in the region to how dangerous Iran is for them, because the Iranians bring with them havoc and chaos for wherever they are, in Lebanon, in Syria, in Iraq, in Yemen. Wherever they go, it's a terrible situation comes with them, including in Iran itself. So it's an opportunity for Israel and for the international community to take advantage of that, take care of the threat the Iranians present in the region and in Iran itself with their attempt to develop nuclear weapons and do something about all these issues.
Indeed. Colonel Kemp, I'd like to hear your perspective on this, but I'd like also to ask you, as the former British commander of the British forces in Afghanistan, of course, you have your own opinions about the American withdrawal, which brought about also the British withdrawal as well as other NATO allies from that country. It seems like the Americans are calling the shots with regard to the negotiations about trying to return into compliance with the JCPOA and everything to do with that. Is that a right assessment, or are the British, the French, the Germans calling their own shots, or the providing their own perspectives to the story, or what is happening there behind the scenes?
I think the first thing I would question now is whether or not Iran actually wants any kind of return to the JCPOA for real. Obviously, they did at one stage. I think one needs to wonder whether that's still the case, or whether, in fact, they're simply using the current negotiations with the Europeans directly to strengthen their own position. And it's important they do that. It's important that they wring every concession they possibly can out of the Americans while giving no concessions themselves whatsoever in order to demonstrate their strength to their own people. The regime, I think, now, and we've seen, you know, very, very serious demonstrations throughout Iran in the past couple of weeks, particularly, the regime is concerned about its own survival. And I think, as well as putting down those demonstrations, which Raisi has a record of dealing very, very brutally with such activity, he is the ideally placed man to do that. Although, of course, being the man he is, he might well go beyond what is sustainable and make the masses much worse. But that is a priority for the Iranian government. And I think showing their people that they are strong and will not be dictated to and will not allow the Americans to and the other members of the JCPOA to have control or access to their nuclear program, I think is something that really does seize them at the moment and suggests to me that they're not really serious about any returning in any form to the JCPOA, which is, in my view, is a good thing. As General Kupavasa mentioned, it's certainly not in Israel or the world's interests for the JCPOA to be reinitiated, because it does even more than what they're doing now. It does sort of legitimately pave the way to a nuclear weapon. I think, funnily enough, I think the Europeans are more kind of driving the current determination to get back to the JCPOA than the Americans are. I think the Americans are actually having some kind of second thoughts over it. They may not have concluded what they want to conclude yet, the people they're dealing with it. But I think the Europeans are very, very enthusiastic about returning to the deal and always have been, in certainly many countries in Europe are. And the I think, you know, we see their almost desperation in that by, as you mentioned, sending a representative to the inauguration of this mass murderer, Raisi. We haven't touched on it yet, but the attack, recent attack on the Japanese-owned ship that is administered by a British company owned by an Israeli, the attack on that, the European Union is refusing to condemn Iran for that. Now, it's not as if they haven't got the intelligence. I'm absolutely certain that if Britain, if the US are privy to the intelligence that may have been provided to them by Israel on that attack, then the EU will be aware of all they need in order to make a condemnation, but they won't do so because they are frightened of doing anything that will prevent, that will give Iran an excuse not to accede back to the JCPOA. And I think the reasoning for that is twofold. Firstly, they have their economic interests in maintaining and increasing their relations, their economic relations with Iran. Hence, again, they sent their representative to the inauguration. And also, the EU is a kind of a wannabe superpower in search of a mission. And if they were able to pull off on behalf of America the re-entry or re-establishment of the JCPOA, that would be, in their view, a great diplomatic triumph, and they will have that very strongly in their mind. In terms of Afghanistan, all these things are, of course, linked. Iran itself does have major interests in Afghanistan. The decision by President Biden to unconditionally withdraw all forces from Afghanistan without any reference to the security situation there was a fundamental and a grave mistake, which is now being explicitly stated by the president of Afghanistan. He's essentially is accusing the Americans of fueling the new or really allowing, shall we say, the new offensive that's taking place as we speak in some of the urban areas of Afghanistan, particularly Lashkar Gah, the capital of the of Helmand, the provincial capital of Helmand. He is basically saying this is because of the extremely rapid and really to a large extent unplanned withdrawal of U.S. forces, which of course encourages the Taliban, and even more importantly, is a big blow to the Afghan National Security Forces, who are, you know, they're fighting, I think, a brave and a strong battle for Lashkar Gah in particular, and also Herat and Kandahar. But you know, their morale will have taken a big blow, and morale is one of the most important factors in warfare. And that is something that, of course, has ensured that Britain must withdraw. Britain couldn't possibly stay in Afghanistan without the Americans nor the Germans. It's going to be a tragedy in Afghanistan for reasons we all understand. If the Taliban actually do take these cities, and that creates a domino effect, and they take over the whole country or most of it, that obviously brings devastation to the Afghan people. But also, it has global effects. It means that there will be almost certainly, if Afghanistan is again in the control of the Taliban, it again becomes a safe haven for jihadists from around the world and enables them to launch attacks from there. It results also in a mass refugee problem. Afghans are already the second largest refugee population in the world. It's likely that will increase with the refugees going to Pakistan, into Iran, and of course, eventually in large numbers into Europe. So I think that those things will be all major problems, on top of which it will weaken the US position in the world, because those countries that the US is trying to persuade away from China and into the Western sphere will be thinking, well, why would we do this? We have a United States that does not stand by its friends and allies, that betrays them in effect, as we've seen in Afghanistan. And we saw the same effect in relation to Saudi Arabia and other Middle Eastern countries over President Obama's policies on Iran, and effectively kind of letting down his long-standing allies in the Middle East.
Indeed, this is, of course, a theater of operations that is not touched enough upon here in TV7, for that matter, because we do focus more on the Middle East. But it does impact the Middle East and Israel in particular as well, because of obviously we are part and parcel of this region. But I'd like to ask you, Mr. Olin, to what degree does the current situation in Iran, particularly the economic situation, which is quite devastating, there are protests both in the north and in other regions where minorities are the dominant factor and are being quite persecuted on a regular basis, not only persecuted but also shunned from basic commodities to be able to live with dignity. So we see all of this lining up and challenging the regime, of course, time and again, on the capacity to truly have a grip on that country. Yet at the same time, we see them trying to expand further, impacting the situation in Yemen, impacting the situation in Lebanon, two countries on the verge of the abyss, and of course Iraq, which is quite a challenging area of operations. How do you see all of this challenging also Israel's security, for that matter, and trying to maneuver in such a way that relative stability will still keep Israel safe from possible wider conflagration?
Well, labor unrest, especially in the oil industry, and if you add to that students taking to the streets and other people, this has always been the nightmare of whoever ruled Tehran from the days of the Shah on. And obviously, there is always a debate at the top of whatever regime is in there, whether they are acting too harshly or too softly. What could bring down the regime if they are not calibrating it properly? And there were some hopes in Israel some 15, 20, 30 years ago that such unrest could topple the Islamic regime. But no leader, no Lech Walesa or any one of that caliber has emerged to be the sort of person to galvanize the protest movement. And the regime, of course, has bolstered itself with both the IRGC and the Bassage, many layers of protection, and as you all said, with brutal policies of suppression. So one may yet see the demise of this regime somewhere down the road, but not anytime soon. Now, this has some impact on foreign policy, because obviously, just as we saw when an air defense officer shot down an airliner, of course, the regime will say that, yes, the Mercer Street incident, if proven, can be linked to an Iranian, but not to Iran, because it was a rogue operation. Obviously, they will have such a fallback position if they are implicated, as well they should be, because obviously Israeli intelligence, even though it could not have forewarned the ships' owners and operators that this attack is coming, after the fact has accumulated all the evidence. Now, right after the attack, it was linked by people in Iran to an Israeli attack against an Iranian facility in Syria. So obviously there is such a connection, and all of that connects to what you talked about regarding the nuclear business. But one comment, if I may, the Europeans and the Chinese and the Russians did not withdraw from the JCPOA. It was only the Trump administration, followed by the Iranians, which is why the Iranians are willing to talk to all the other parties to the deal, but not directly to the Americans. Anyway, one hopes that there are some clandestine channels still being worked on right now in order to find some formula.
With that being said, if the Iranians reach a certain line, General Kupelwasser, you already spoke about this in our previous program, which was aired last Friday, Israel has red lines, which it already stated under the Netanyahu leadership at the time. Is this still alive today? Are all the options on the table? And does Israel have the international backing to follow through on those options if it does undertake in a preemptive strike of possibly a nuclear-armed Iran?
I don't know if the red lines that you used to have in the past are still in place. We have a different government, of course, but and this different government is so committed to discussing any move concerning Iran with the Iranians that the entire idea of a red line is blurred now. But I think we should be very clear on two things. First of all, that we shall not allow Iran to have the capability to produce a nuclear weapon. And secondly, that we shall take whatever steps are that are necessary in order to prevent that from happening. And that these are the things that we should be committed to. And in order to be able to say it with straight face, we have to have a plan and the capability to follow what we are saying. And on that, we heard the Israeli chief of staff speaking several times, and the minister of defense as well, saying that they are committed to having this plan. They are working on it, and we have a special branch in the chief of staff organization that is committed to dealing with this matter. And I hope that we have a plan for that. Otherwise, there is no credible threat to deter Iran, because the Iranians are not that afraid from the Americans. The Americans, up till now, the American administration has not even said that all options are on the table. Something we used to hear from Obama, not only from Trump. So we are dealing here with a situation where the Iranians may think that they have some sort of carte blanche to take all kinds of steps, as I said before, and because the Americans are not going to do anything about it. And they are now actually putting them to a test. It's because they crossed another red line of, you know, the Americans always were saying, don't dare to kill Americans. If you do kill Americans, then the sky is going to fall. So they didn't kill an American, but they did kill a British guy. And is the United States committed to go hand in hand with Britain in order to make it clear to the Iranians that this is totally unacceptable and there's a heavy price for doing something like that? I don't know. We shall see. So it's definitely Israel cannot be a part of this riddle of what Israel is going to do or not. Israel should be clear that it's not going to allow Iran to have the capability to have nuclear to develop nuclear weapons, and that it has the capability to take action if something like that happens.
Well, unfortunately, this is all the time that we have for today. I'd like to thank General Yossi Kupelwasser, Colonel Richard Kemp, as well as Mr. Amir Oren. And we'll revisit this topic, of course, as it's an ongoing story that unfortunately doesn't see a lot of light at the end of this tunnel. But I'd like also to thank our viewers, and we will see you next time.